HarperCollins presents Shadows of a Princess, Diana, Princess of Wales, 1987 to 1996. An Intimate Account by Her Private Secretary, by Patrick Jephson. Read by Patrick Jephson. Preface. For more than 7 years, from 1988 to 1996, I shadowed the Princess of Wales. As her private secretary, her closest advisor, I was with her throughout the events leading up to her separation from Prince Charles. I helped her carve out a new life as an independent princess on the world stage. I watched her struggle with enemies from outside, as well as others, more murky, that threatened her from within. As the darkness finally gathered around her, our paths parted. By then, she was standing in her own light, obscuring the way ahead for herself and for many who would have acknowledged her as a global force for good. Since her death in 1997, I have come to question the credentials of some of the self-appointed guardians of her thoughts, motives, and values. It seemed to me that history was recording an image which bore little resemblance to the princess I knew better than most. It is common sense, not treason, to believe that the truth will do her no harm now. Neglecting the truth will profit only those who seek to gain, personally, financially, or constitutionally, from letting the weeds of misrepresentation slowly overgrow her memory. Of the many others who shared those years with me, I ask forbearance where their recollections differ from mine. Of the many more who did not, I ask nothing but an open mind. What follows, so far as it lies in my power, is the truth. Part 1. In. Chapter 1. Over the Top. The Princess of Wales was watching the man with unusual intensity. She leaned forward in her chair, anxious not to miss any of the action she had just been promised. Her eyes widened with anticipation. The man obviously did not know he was being watched, but he was ill at ease, definitely shifty. He seemed to be waiting for someone and was losing patience. He took a few paces to the left, then a few to the right. He scratched his tangled, dirty hair and looked anxiously up and down the street. I didn't like the look of him. Then a second man appeared, dodging between a couple of pedestrians. If anything, the newcomer was even more nervous. He looked jumpy and his arms made strange twitching movements as he spoke rapidly into the other man's ear. They seemed to be making some kind of deal because I saw money changing hands, but I couldn't hear what they said. Suddenly they were walking off together, slipping into a deserted alleyway next to the station. Still they did not know they were being watched. What happened next made the princess shriek with a kind of thrilled horror. As we watched, with a final furtive look around, the first man loosened his jeans and crouched forward. There was a look of fixed concentration on his face. For 5 seconds he didn't move. I had just realized he was defecating when his hand disappeared down the seat of his pants and emerged a few seconds later clutching a small package. Quickly he passed it to the other man, clearly his customer. Then, without a backward glance, the pusher adjusted his belt and returned to his position on the street. The police officer stretched across the princess and switched off the video with a click. Her hands were still clutched theatrically to her face, the shock of what she had seen still obvious in her eyes as she peeped from between her fingers. She caught my glance and giggled. Obscenity usually made her giggle. "Ugh! Talk about a video nasty! I hope you arrested him." "Oh, he's an old friend, ma'am, and so are most of his customers. We keep them under surveillance with these TV cameras. Then we move in when we've got the evidence we need." The inspector stood up and reached for his leather jacket. There was a whiff of aftershave. He looked every inch TV's idea of an undercover cop. I had noticed the princess register his star quality as we arrived at his office half an hour earlier. That was good. An attractive male lead always brought out the best in our unpredictable royal performer. "If you're ready," he said, heading for the door with an athlete's easy grace. His amused expression promised further treats in store. The princess followed him meekly. Her eyes were demurely lowered, as if to retain the image she had just seen. I knew she was enjoying herself. She was fascinated by the forbidden. 2 minutes later, we were outside, on the late rush hour streets of King's Cross. Night had fallen. It started to rain. Out of the darkness, a solitary flash bulb popped. I heard the Nikon's motor drive as my boss reacted with a loud sigh of exasperation. "Oh, wretched press! They follow me everywhere!" The plaintive note was easy to hear. Too easy, I thought. "You're overdoing it." But it earned her a sympathetic look from our handsome guide, so that was good, too. As we moved unnoticed into the hurrying crowds, I took up my familiar position, slightly behind the tall figure with the expensively casual hairdo. Tonight she was in black jeans and a short, sexy jacket. This was our version of incognito. The Princess of Wales, icon of the oppressed and champion of the socially excluded, was beginning another secret fact-finding tour. Tramping round King's Cross that night, I felt again the familiar wrench in my gut. It always came when I thought of where the princess had been and where she was going. The sensation was becoming much more frequent. It was the same feeling you get on a roller coaster as it stops climbing and begins to dive toward the ground. She had been so high. The future queen. Now she was still high, at least with the people we were meeting on the street. And the papers said she was a phenomenon. The looks of a supermodel and the heart of a saint. But I knew the truth. I had seen many saintly things done in her name. And if she was not exactly saint material herself, as she would be quick to agree, she had certainly done a lot of suffering. Not all of it had been done in public either, as some would have you believe. Now, however, she was floundering. Where once she had been the ideal young wife and mother, now she was a self-proclaimed adulteress. Where once she had been worshipped by charities, now she was worshipped for her photo spreads. Where once she had summoned Air Force jets, now she cadged lifts in planes smelling of rich men's cologne. True, there were always going to be causes begging for this kind of celebrity patronage. And she had built up deep reserves of public sympathy. She still had that magical forgivability. But I knew these were the gifts more of others' mistakes than of her shining virtues. I knew she had begun to believe her own publicity, just as I was believing it less and less. I felt there was now no way back to the happy certainties of my early days at the palace. How had it all changed? 8 years earlier, it had all been so different. Another world, almost another universe. Autumn 1987. Somewhere on the long journey from Scotland, I had lost my cufflinks. Summoned from the frigate Arethusa while she was pausing in her patrol to refuel in a stormy west coast sea lock, I had taken a boat, two buses, an aeroplane, and a taxi to reach the Kensington Hotel that was my base for the coming ordeal. Along the way, the cufflinks, with their family crest and a wealth of sentimental value, had disappeared, never to return. Some frantic improvisation was called for. Dejectedly, I substituted collar studs, one of the archaic pieces of kit which gave the Navy its charm for me. It seemed a bad omen, not least because in those days any meeting with royalty was a signal for sartorial precision of the highest order. This was no ordinary meeting either. It was a job interview. By some quirk of fate, I had been chosen, along with five others, as a candidate to be the next equerry to the Princess of Wales. I knew little about what an equerry actually did, but I didn't greatly care. I already knew I wanted to do the job. 2 years on loan to the royal household would surely be good for promotion. And even if it wasn't, it had to be better than slaving in the Ministry of Defence, which was the most likely alternative. I wondered what it would be like to work in a palace. Through friends and relatives, I had an idea it was not all red carpets and footmen. Running the royal family must involve a lot of hard work for somebody, I realized, but not surely for the type of tiny cog that was all I expected to be. In the wardroom of the frigate, alongside in Loch Yew, news of the signal summoning me to London for interview had been greeted with predictable ribaldry, and a swift expectation that I therefore owed everybody several free drinks. Doug, our quiet American on loan from the U.S. Navy, spoke for many. He observed me in skeptical silence for several minutes. Then he took a long pull at his beer, blew out his moustache, and said, "Let me get this straight. You are going to work for Princess Di?" I had to admit it sounded improbable. Anyway, I hadn't even been selected yet. I didn't honestly think I would be. "Might work for her, Doug. Only might. There's probably several smooth army buggers ahead of me in the queue. I'm just there to make it look democratic." The First Lieutenant, thinking of duty rosters, was more practical. "Whatever about that, you've wangled a week ashore, you jammy bastard." Everyone agreed with him, so I bought more drinks. While these were being poured, my eye fell on the portraits hanging on the bulkhead. There were the regulation official photographs of the Queen and Prince Philip, and there, surprisingly, was a distinctly non-regulation picture of the Princess of Wales, cut from an old magazine and lovingly framed by an officer long since appointed elsewhere. The picture had been hung so that it lay between the formality of the official portraits and the misty eroticism of some art prints we had never quite got round to throwing away. The symbolic link did not require the services of one of the notoriously sex-obsessed naval psychologists for interpretation. As she looked down at us in our off-duty moments, the princess represented youth, femininity, and a glamour beyond our grey steel world. She embodied the innocent vulnerability we were, in extremis, employed to defend. Also, being royal, she commanded the tribal loyalty our profession had valued above all else since the days of King Alfred. In addition, as a matter of simple fact, this tasty-looking bird was our future queen. Later, when that day in Loch Yew felt like a relic from another lifetime, I often marveled at the princess's effect on military people. That unabashed loyalty, symbolized by Arethusa's portrait, was typical of reactions in messes and barracks worldwide. Sometimes the men gave the impression that they would have died for her, not because it was their duty, but because they wanted to. She really seemed worth it. So this is where she lives, I thought. I stood by the gates to Kensington Palace, or KP as I came to call it, and looked up the long drive to where another set of gates, the security barrier, guarded the entrance to what is in fact a kind of royal compound. The usual picture the public sees of KP is only one short face of a rectangular complex of buildings. Behind this facade, the favoured backdrop of TV reporters doing a Princess Di story, lies a warren of courtyards and gardens. Around these are an assortment of grand state apartments and smaller private apartments where the Waleses, Princess Margaret, and other royal people have their London homes. I suppose if you have to live in a palace, this is the one to choose, in London at least. It sits at one end of Hyde Park, and if you look out of a window facing north, east, or south, the view is mostly of trees and grass. If you look west, you can see the smart houses in Millionaire's Row. Insulated from the noise of London's traffic.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.